Today, we get a new GPU and games ill-optimized and focusing on both, RTX 4090. The one I got is a generic NVIDIA, similar to the last gen in look. But it's higher. And equipped with three slots and over the shoulder. The non-stock radiator this year is long and huge. Hard to be crammed into the big cassock, let alone into the ATX. The generic one is relatively smaller. Not too exaggerated. The new GPU's made the biggest progress in the process. It's equipped with TSMC for nanometers. That scales up performance and performance per watt. At first, I planned to follow the routine to analyze the changes of architecture and test performances of games. But then I thought, there's an overflow of performance tests done by KOLs. That leads to a trend of content homogenization. And for us, we excel at performance tests of laptop, as opposed to those of desktop PC. So, as an unprofessional YouTuber in the digital channel, I made up my mind to do something different this time, to provide pioneering data for 40 series laptops users. TGP of this GPU meets 450W at default. Certainly too high to reach for laptops. So, we connected it to the desktop PC. Set CPU and memory closer to specs of a gaming laptop. Lowered the power consumption of GPU and compared the performance at default. Thus, we could project its performance on laptops. We also tried it on laptops with an external GPU to see how it would perform. All right, let's get it started. Simple introduction to the test platform. The GPU is the generic RTX 4090. CPU is the iCore 912900K. Motherboard is ROG Z690 Apex. Dual channel memory with 216GB G. Skill Trident Z5 Neo. XPM off. The frequency state at DAR 5480 ohms. A laptop serving as the control group. Is the flagship gaming laptop MSI Titan GT77. iCore 9 plus 3080 Titanium 175W. We chose it for it reflects the performance of its kind. As usual, we first analyze the specs. RTX 4090 adopts the latest TSMC for nanometers. Much more improved than the 30 series Samsung 8 nanometers. I believe you must have heard of it. As long as you focus on Snapdragon 888. For the cores, architecture changed as well. Ampere used by the last gen has been replaced by Ada Lovelace for the new gen. RTX 4090's core is at 102, 11 groups of GPC and 128 groups of SM unit in total. CUDA has 16,384 cores. Small cut on the basis of complete add 102. And one spec of the 40 series has changed much. That is, the L2 cache. L2 cache of 4090 is 73,728 kilobytes. Namely about 71 meters. 10 times that of 3090 with the same positioning. The architecture graph shows that a large area of the Ada core is designated for cache. Large cache can, to some degree, reduce GPU's reliance on high-speed RAM. Designed in such a way, laptop without high-speed jitter 6x RAM still won't have serious bottlenecks of RAM. But in almost all cases, 102, the biggest core, is doomed to mismatch laptops. So we compared 4080 16 grams and 4080 12 grams, each equipped with a 103 and a 104 respectively, both applicable to laptops. Changes in specs are clear. First, bit width of the two VRAMs has been shortened to 256-bit and 192-bit respectively. For comparison, the Ampere card last year has 384-bit. This indicated smaller need of a 103 and a 104 for bandwidth of RAM. The second agreeable change lies in power consumption, compared with 3080 Titanium. TGP of 4080 16 grams reduced to 320W. 4080 12 grams also has its TGP, dropping to 285W from 350W. New process seems to help a lot reducing consumption. Okay, having had a look at the specs, I'm eager to see its actual performance. We selected softwares and games we're familiar with. For an easier comparison with 30 series laptop, we chose 3DMark as the benchmark. For the games, we tested CSGO, Shadow of the Tomb Raider, Metro Exodus, and Cyberpunk 2077. Each represents games well-optimized and focusing on CPU. Games ill-optimized and focusing on GPU. Let's check the benchmark first. The default setting of power consumption. RTX 4090 scored 36,208 in 3DMark Timespeed, 3 times higher than the mobile 175W3080 Titanium. Really incredible! One GPU is able to equal 3 flagship gaming laptops. Marveling at such strong theoretical performance, we also wondered how games would perform in 4000 lowest settings. CSGO reached 800 FPS. Although we switched on the lowest settings, it was 4000 resolution after all. The FPS is even higher than a laptop with only 960p. So dope! But when we adjusted it to 2000, FPS only increased to 857, slightly improved, probably because of the bottlenecks of CPU or memory. for 3 games. Tomb Raider with 4000 resolution ran to 183fps, higher than 175W3080 Titanium with 1080p. Metro Exodus with 4000 had 70 more FPS than 3080Ti Titanium 2077 without ray tracing, also achieved 80 FPS. Its new flagship desktop GPU with 4000 resolution can perform equally well or even better than 30 series gaming laptops with 1080p, indeed a huge progress. Some of you may say, Juan, consumption of RTX 4090 is 450W at default, but laptop GPU has only 175W at max. It's so unfair. That's true. So shall we put limits on the consumption? By using Afterburner, we limited the GPU to 38% of its max. Now the consumption during operation was about 170W. Basically equivalent to 3080 Titanium. So, how would 4090 with lowered consumption perform? Let's see the result. CSGO lost only a few dozens of frames, lightly influenced. Frames of the three single-player games surely would fall. It's mainly because the large scale of cores of 4090 requires high consumption to support cores and RAM. So in the case where power fails to feed them all, only by being optimized by a certain voltage curve, can the frequency achieve a good performance. In such a rough way of lowering power consumption, GPU must limit the frequency to work normally, but even so, the strong performance of a TX 4090 is unignorable, with performance over 30% higher than 175W3080 Titanium. We roughly analyzed the reasons of its performance elevation. First, TGP of this GPU is 450W, but even when the power consumption's unrestricted, GPU reached only about 350W when the three games were running, pretty different than the 30 series GPU. Second, with power consumption under control, TSMC has better performance per watt at LF than Samsung. So, on the laptop platform, even when power consumption's not high, loss of performance won't be substantial. So, it seems that the flagship GPU of the next gen, with the power consumption remaining unchanged, is projected to improve its performance by 50%. The range of improvement perfectly enables most standalone games to run to 60fps with 4000 resolution. It also means that laptops equipped with the 40 series GPU can make full use of its 4120Hz HD gaming screen. This thought, I can hardly wait to try a gaming laptop with 4090 right now, right here. The 40 series mobile GPU isn't released yet, but we can resort to the old-fashioned method. Yes, the external docking station. Laptops with Thunderbolts can be connected to a docking station to allow the running of RTX 4090. We tried it on the 30 series GPU before, but with the docking station restricted by bandwidth, FPS were much lower than those on the desktop platform. So I'm curious, will external 4090 and 3090 see further improvements in the performance, or it's just as we expected, that the bandwidth of external 3090 has fallen short? And the same will happen to external 4090. In our test, we still used the Lenovo graphic amplifier, cooperating with Jiaxin Pro 14 Intel Core, i-Core 512 500H plus 16 grams, DAR5 for 80 ohms. We confronted troubles just at the beginning. 4090, a standard 3-slot card, is too big, unable to fit the graphic amplifier. So we had to use the PCIe extension cable to connect the GPU to docking station. Power supply is also a major trouble. The docking station has only 8 plus 6 pin ports, but the power supply cable of 4909 needs for 8 pin ports. Clearly, the original power supply isn't enough and should be supplemented by external power. Well, the solution might seem wild, but it doesn't matter as long as the performance isn't undermined. So how's the performance? First, let's look at the data of 3090. With an external graphic amplifier, RTX 3090 plus i-Core 512-500H with 4000 resolution, CSGO ran to 4-6.1fps, Tomb Raider 82fps, Metro Exodus 54fps, and 2077 42fps. Pretty good compared to the 10th and 11th gens of Intel Core. This gen has much better performance of games. At least the games are playable. And how about the data of 4090? To my surprise, 4090 performed even better. As CSGO scored 600fps, over 170fps higher than 3090. Other games that are burdensome to GPU also saw elevation in FPS in various degrees. In benchmark, 2077 even didn't fail to meet 60fps. That's what I didn't expect. It never occurred to me that, with bottlenecks of physical bandwidth, 4090 with an external docking station could even have better improvement in FPS than 3090, despite the hard bandwidth restriction. Okay, after reviewing all the tests, now we can draw three conclusions. First, RTX 40 series GPU has strong performance. Finer process enables more transistors squeezed in smaller chips. Besides, the large cache lowers GPU's reliance on RAM. A good news for laptops. Second, RTX 4090 laptops set to simulate laptops still performed equally to the desktop 3090, even when the consumption decreased to about 170W. Performance per watt has increased significantly. Third, external 4090 has stronger graphic performance than 3090. But they are both subjected to bandwidth restriction, and thus have their performance undermined. Tight in time, we did the tests in a hurry, with many features like ray tracing and DLSS3 excluded. After the official launch of the 40 series for mobiles, we'll make compliments in an additional detailed test. It's truly a victory of consumers who wait and see. Okay, this is all for today's test of the generic RTX 4090. If you like it, please give us a like and follow us. If you want to interact with me every day, please follow us on WeChat official account to provide info and guidance. This is Viva Laptops. I'm Juan. See you next time. Bye.